campaign in Elderton, actually, a public value of the bridge. Like, I didn't give it a public. I'm confused.
And we move on to item three, minutes of our meeting held on the 2nd of June. Presumably everyone's read.
Yes.
Happy to the correct record.
Yes.
This is my son. So, strictly moving on to agenda item four.
Just to provide members with a summary of the standards and complaints which are analysed. All
say that there is a pattern in that sense. The numbers that have been one of eight, we don't have that coming through. What I do, as you know, is advise the group leaders on matters which affect members within their group so they can see both repeat councillors who are coming up, as well as issues if there are themes developing within specific groups for them to consider what action they need to take.
Thank you. Thank you.
If we don't know who these members are and we're not going to be told, what's the point of you bringing it into it if we can't do a very dramatic thing? Why wouldn't I tell you this?
A couple of things really. One is that the member that the committee wanted details of the complaints. Under our protocol as it currently drafted, matters remain confidential, or we try and keep matters confidential with parties three, so that due process can be followed through. The protocol deals with where matters are dealt with in the public sphere, and that is where matters, where the potential breach of the code from the investigation report has been then considered by standards panel, which determines whether or not the issue should be considered in the public. The protocol members agreed as part of the working group to try and manage the process by maintaining confidentiality rather than having issues with Cllr before the process.
Is this a sort of Cliff Richard defence whereby you only publish it as a firm or person or whatever is found to be transgressed? Is that the idea?
The idea is
to understand, as my colleague is saying, trying to understand the rationale behind making a record of it, but then we have many more than that.
No, that, that's the issue. The issue was that an allegation gets made, we look at and I look at how best with the views being of the independent person being canvassed, how best to deal with it. Issue that includes referring them to investigation. We have had some successes with actual local resolution whereby alternative action being taken where an issue between complainant and the subject councillor by taking a different route to an investigation has actually resulted in better
outcome. So it's resolved
to problem properly. But to the satisfaction of the complainant as well as the subject councillor, which has been helpful, which is part of the problem of the old regime, which was very rigid and which didn't enable you to do that. So we have a stage whereby we look at the development complaint, take a view from the independent person, look at the best way of dealing with it, often liaising with the parties involved, and that can be resolved in a more effective way in order to do so.
So who are you doing this?
Who's doing that?
Who are making these decisions?
I am, as part of the process.
So we are, as a member, we have no option whatsoever.
Only insofar as if a matter gets referred to investigation, and the investigator concludes that there is a, in his or her opinion, a breach of the code by the subject councillor, then under our arrangements that we agreed, a standard panel is convened, which is made up of members, and members deal with matters where there is a finding of a breach of the code. So that your involvement is where there has been a breach as opposed to some other resolution or no case to answer.
I think the trouble is that we're not part of that decision. Because you're making it, therefore how can it be scrutinised? Okay, I'm not trying to create a bad
thing,
just you're not trying to understand the rationale behind you having, quite frankly, maybe, a final decision on whether to take it any further. But that isn't being scrutinised by anybody. Your decision is being
scrutinised. No, and I agree, and that was striking the balance between flexibility to ensure matters are not dealt with in a more bureaucratic way, because that was part of the problem with the old regime, where everything was subjected to a more formalised process, which was both bureaucratic, time-consuming, and some issues and matters which didn't necessarily warrant that level of process. And members, when we put together the protocol through the working group, wanted a more used to have 4 or 5 pages, but there's clearly been improvements since the old days.
Yes, and we have the process and timetable for matters to be dealt with have increased and improved, so we're not dealing with complaints which are taking that long to deal with. It doesn't mean that there's not improvements to be made. And the next item for you to consider again is the establishing of a working group, and part of the work of the working group is to again review the code and the protocol that deals with how the arrangements for dealing with complaints, and it's the opportunity for members to decide how much more involvement they wish in complaints. I don't have any particular view on members involved in this matter for members as to how they wish to manage complaints, and you can be involved in to whatever extent you wish to. But there's obviously implications to that in terms of capacity, how we manage that, and it does impact on how quickly matters are then dealt with as well, etc. So I'm quite happy to explore all that with members in whichever way you wish to proceed.
Can I just apologise for diving in without asking your permission, Chair?
You probably would.
Apologies, Chair.
You're talking to the Standards Committee, please.
Set out timescales for Mr. Tour to operate, and one of the things that we puzzled about is
circumstances which are brought to happen today. But we do need to look at how we can actually speed that process up, because I think it's necessary to at least explore how we can make that as well.
Surely through you, Chair, the default position should be it should be had to know that the mechanisms are as possible in the interest of all the parties. So.
Yes, and that's what we try to do. But there are, I think recent experiences, there are areas where I think we can look at how we can potentially improve or look at how we can expedite proceedings where particular circumstances arise, which to which there's not a simple answer, but does require careful analysis and discussion. Which is where the working group becomes quite helpful, because members, I can candidly have a more detailed conversation with members around some of the issues so that we can make appropriate amendments to the protocol to help manage matters going forward. So you have the whole issue about the current management of complaints, but also importantly an opportunity for members to look at how the council can promote and maintain high standards of conduct, which is indeed the duty imposed under the Lucas Act. And that's a conversation that we do have and try to have during the working at the working group. The other half of the work of the working group is to look at the constitution, because there's no standards and constitutional oversight. And we, last year there was a significant piece of work done around the council procedures, resulting in changes to the way in which council is currently operated. We said we'd keep that, those arrangements under review during this municipal year to ensure that the objectives of those changes have been met. So, a page paragraph 4-3, I've summarised that very briefly. The subject areas that the working group previously last year looked at, of which it says further review required, paragraph 4.4 of those three items there: code, the protocol, the ICT policy, and civic handbook and flag flying protocol. The recommendations of the working group last year were in relation to the council's constitution and guidance to members on appointments to outside bodies, which is the next item on this agenda, which was both of which were approved by the working group, subsequent committee and council, the last item. And then from paragraph 4.6 onwards, this is suggested the work programme for the working group. There's a couple of standard items there in terms of review of the constitution and the review of code of conduct and protocol. The members' ICT policy was a piece of work that was we did the lion's share of the work, and what's left is the final review and sign off by the working group. Likewise, the civic handbook and climate protocol. And there's just one other additional amendment which I've asked to be circulated, and that links in with the independent persons discussion. No suggestion, obviously, we've dealt with the issue of the reappointment of the existing independent persons So we would, on this just follows on from the work of the working group of last year, which approved this note. The working group was of the view that one thing the members hadn't got for their reference is some support or guidance around what they need to bear in mind and consider when appointed by outside bodies. It's not intended to be a detailed note. In fact, it's intended to provide a lighter read, or at least hopefully provide members with some key points to bear in mind when they sit on the board of companies, whether local trust, charity trustees, etc., so that they're aware of their obligations, because their obligations are not to the council, but they have fiduciary duties and obligations to the organisation to which they've been appointed. And getting that balance right and understanding some of those issues was seen as quite important for members to not lose sight of. And so the working group was of the view that having a guidance note for members to assist them with regards to outside bodies would be helpful, and that was approved by the working group and is brought back to you for your consideration of final approval before we can share the note or the guidance note with all members.
So in end point one,
members to be aware of your providing support to members so that they're aware of their obligations and they're sitting on those bodies, so that, as you rightly say, you need to be acting in the best interest of the organisation to which you've been appointed, but you do bring to the table your experiences and